thank you for coming back. In part two, I want to explore why does the power structure, why does the Illuminati New World Order power structure see or at least pretends to see Donald Trump as such a threat? Is Donald Trump really a threat? I mean, if you look at his behavior, certainly he was against NATO, now he's for NATO. He was, against the terrorists. Now he's cozying up to the world's biggest state sponsor of terrorism, the Saudis. He pretended to be, reconciliatory toward Russia, but we've seen the behavior of Washington's military forces, especially in Syria, with the full backing and blessing of Donald Trump. So I think he's just a pawn. I mean, he can't possibly, I mean, he fooled a lot of people, a lot of destitute, hopeless, economically disadvantaged American voters into thinking they represent, he represents them. But even those people are waking up to some extent. There's an argument from a lot of his supporters still, these are diehard supporters, who are not necessarily racist, who are not Islamophobic. Their argument, and we have to entertain this argument for the sake of this production, is that Donald Trump really, he not only rode this wave, this populist wave, this libertarian wave, although he's not a libertarian, we don't know what Donald Trump is. You know, he's loathed by conservatives, he's hated religiously by the liberals, but at least through his campaign months, he pretended to cater to a lot of the ideals of the libertarian movement, the ideals that people like Ron Paul talked about for decades, literally. And this guy basically rode this wave of discontent in the country, and people bought the lie that he may represent them. A billionaire representing, the regular hardworking or even not hardworking people who are jobless, who have been systematically jobless for decades. They saw this, and again, this was another sort of manipulating the public attention, which this media, the same crooked media, the same fake news media, didn't really challenge Mr. Trump. I remember the interviews. They never challenged him the way they are totally scrutinizing right now. And so that was part of the plan. They told the media not to really challenge or scrutinize or ask difficult questions. Yes, they did pose some questions on the debates, just to make sure it's legitimate, which it wasn't. But when he came to interviews, they practically let him get away with murder. It was incredible. So that was part of the agenda. I believe he's part of that whole one world government system. However, these people, these Rothschilds and Rockefellers and these 13 blood families who are ruling the world, at least in the West, and they have grandiose globalist ideas on how to run the entire world and how to get rid of any government, any system, any president, any leader who stands up to them, they are such control freaks. I call them the architects of control. They're such control freaks that even when it comes to one of their own, which they install, well, relatively speaking, one of their own, which they install in the White House, they're suspicious that because of his stances, because of Donald Trump's stances in having or in projecting this idea of having some kind of a reconciliation with Russia, they're so hell-bent in wanting to create another World War III in order to have a hyperinflationary situation, to implement World War III, to eventually and essentially wipe off the debt, the $20 trillion debt. They're so hell-bent on this endgame that anyone, including someone like Donald Trump, who would be installed as U.S. president, they're hell-bent in trying to make sure that part of Donald Trump's agenda, in other words, reconciliation with Russia, would never happen. These neocon, neolib monsters never want a multipolar, arrangement. This whole new world order that they talked about in the early 90s through their 33-degree Mason George Bush Sr. Some people say he's a 90-degree Mason. Go figure that out, a 90-degree Mason. We used to think 33-degree is the highest. This phrase, New World Order, was essentially a code for a unipolar world order in which United States basically plays the policeman of the world, gets to be the bully, gets to interject and project and impose its agenda on the rest of the world. And anyone who would get in the way, they would get rid of, if they can, militarily. In North Korea, they haven't been able to do that because North Korea is a nuclear state. In Iran, they try to do everything and anything possible to reverse the Iranian, the peaceful advancement of Iranian nuclear technology, and they got what they wanted through the JCPOA, which was, if you ask me, was a treasonous contract that are foolish and are naive and are short-sighted Iranian colleagues signed up to, thinking they are going to avert disaster, something they haven't been able to do, and something that some elements within Iran, especially the current presidency, they're sending all these signals to Washington that they, you know, they want to give up the revolutionary zeal. Let's just become part of this new world order. Let's just, you know, sing kumbaya and hold hands and all this nonsense, unrealistic BS, practically. And they want to subscribe to this one world government agenda because they think, these people, unfortunately, in Iran, think that the path of standing out has failed. Let's hope that they have a strategy and what I just told you is not true. Nothing would make me happier than to be proven wrong about what I just stated about some elements in the Iranian leadership cadre, especially the office of the presidency and these green people, you know, the part of the green movement, and these illiterate neoliberals in Iran. But my whole point in bringing this Iranian dossier into this conversation is that, you know, Iran used to be, and we are hoping it would still be, one of the last bastions of standing up to this satanic new world order, along with other countries. Cuba, an interesting development that we've seen in Cuba. President Trump went ahead and reneged and wants to reverse the contracts that were made with the Cubans in, you know, trying to bring the Cubans, I mean, this was by Barack Obama, in wanting to bring the Cubans into this, you know, international community, their phrase. Interestingly, Barack Obama pulled out of that, which inadvertently and as a, you know, like an unintended consequence, is reinforcing, hopefully would reinforce, Cuba's long-standing the position in standing up to the big bad bully imperialist 90 miles to its north. And that would force Cuba back into the arms of what we call NAM, the non-aligned movement countries. You got to keep in mind, there is this other movements on the side. There is the SCO, Shanghai Cooperation Council Organization, which was a first step toward this Eurasian Confederation. This would be a wonderful thing in order to present an alternative to Washington and London's New World Order implemented through their NATO military arm. We have this other movement called Nine Aligned Movement, all these third world countries who are subscribing to this in wanting to stand up to these bullies and creating their own version of resistance, which would consist of many countries, tens and tens of countries. We have the BRICS nations, right? BRICS, of course, consists of Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa, who have another vision, a different vision than IMF and World Trade Organization and all these evil Rothschild organizations who are instruments of, you know, of control. So there's all these other movements that are taking place, and frankly, the rest of the world, especially Russia, a country that's being put into the crosshairs, right? In just being defamed by the fake news channels in the United States. They don't even care. They're focusing so much into the future, into implementing their future plans. And this is why the Washington cabal, Washington City of London. City of London is different than London itself. City of London is practically controlled by these globalist financiers. This is why they want to demonize Russia, because they know Russia is moving very fast into achieving its own agenda in the 21st century, and they want to do everything and anything possible to stop that trend. That's what this whole so-called Russian intervention in our election neurolingual programming phrase is all about. All these non-issues, all these false, baseless stories that are void of any actual evidence. And, you know, Goebbels, the propaganda minister in the Nazi regime, in the 1930s and 40s said, this is something very important that he said. It was sort of it was a giveaway. He said, the more you repeat a lie, the bigger a lie gets, the more people will believe it. And so this is exactly what this Russian situation in the election is all about. The bigger they make this lie without having any open hearings in front of Congress that people, academics like me, can watch on C-SPAN, as long as they keep pushing this story without having any open hearings, then it's, as far as I'm concerned, it's a non-issue. Now, if those hearings actually do happen and real evidence, not fake evidence, real evidence is presented as a mechanism to impeach President Trump, then we have academic responsibility to pay close attention to that. But that time hasn't happened yet. I do wonder if that time ever happens. I'm not a fan of Trump. I wish Donald Trump would get impeached. This is the first openly Zionist president. This is the first president that would make his first foreign country visit after he became president to a savage nation, to a barbaric state-sponsored nation like Saudi Arabia. It's unprecedented. Usually they would go and pay their tribute, you know, to their puppet masters in England. Usually they would go and bow down to the king, to the queen in England. This time, the first trip was actually to Saudi Arabia. Some people say because Trump was thinking economically, he just wanted to give Saudis the shaft and sell them all these weapons. And some people also argue that every time US or Europe, you know, sells highly advanced weaponry to any of these third world countries or any of these Gulf countries, the most sensitive part is not sold to them, to make them, you know, practically completely reliant on the seller. So whatever his agenda was, the symbolic act of going to this barbaric country, to this country who doesn't even have a history of 100 years, to a country that practically has gone from rags to riches. I'm talking about Saudi Arabia. A country that is a misogynist country, a country where women cannot even vote or drive. That he would actually insult the rest of the civilized world by making his first state visit to this country. Practically, I mean, that says so much. And then right after that, he goes to the Zionist entity, another state sponsor of terrorism nation in the Middle East. So I would be the last person who would be mourning if this guy gets impeached. Of course, I'm not happy with Mike Pence, his vice president, either. But Mike Pence, at least he had experience. Mike Pence, at least he was the governor of a major state, Indiana. At least he is part of the experienced cadre, although totally pro-establishment, totally controlled, totally neocon, than Donald Trump. So from that perspective, we can possibly entertain this idea that Donald Trump is viewed by the New World Order Illuminati power structure as a loose cannon, and they should contain him, they should impeach him. However, they also keep in mind that there could be major unrest in the American streets if this actually happens. There could be. I'm not forecasting it would be, but those people that were pissed off before this guy got into power, and they've been pissed off since the 80s. That was the first, you know, sort of phase of jobs being systematically shipped at that time to Taiwan, and then later to China and all these other places. Japan comes to mind, Thailand, all these high-tech jobs and what have you. Also heavy industry jobs. So these people who were already very infuriated and angry, if they see Trump actually get impeached, their anger, their fury is going to be fueled, and God knows what's going to happen. So it's very hard to forecast what the system is going to do to Trump or what the system is pretending to do to Trump. These are two very different things. At any rate, thank you so much for following this analysis. I know I'm being told by my advisors to keep it under 5 minutes, but I do come from academia, and it's very difficult to keep these analyses under 5 minutes because they're extremely complicated, and simplifying them, God forbid oversimplifying them, would be an injustice to truth and to analysis. So I hope you got what you needed out of this. I hope every time you watch a story about, you know, this Russian intervention in our election, that you would just change the channel, that you would actually tune into real media, not fake news channels or fake media, and that you would get your information from solid sources, from independent media, from alternative media. It is very, very important that you do that. It is very, very important that you encourage that to your friends. Very, very important to encourage that to your friends. I finished this taping, this particular video, by a quotation by the great Malcolm X. He said, if you actually read the newspapers, you're going to end up blaming the victims, and you're going to end up praising the victimizers, the oppressors. Something to that effect. I'm paraphrasing what he said. So change the word newspaper to mainstream media. If you watch mainstream media, if that's where you get your news from, you're going to end up blaming the victims, and you're going to end up praising and being on the side of the oppressors. God forbid you do that. Every little thing that every person does on this world makes an impact. That's why we do what we do, one person at a time. At any rate, thank you so much for following our work here. Please don't forget to subscribe to our channel for regular video uploads and updates. Thank you.